now mediating between the United States and Iran. And when did you speak with President Rouhani?
I immediately spoke to President Rouhani yesterday, after the meeting with President Trump. But I can't say anything right now more than this, but except that we are trying and mediating.
So how do you think the situation can be escalated?
I'm hoping that, that there is no conflict. You see, I do not believe that conflicts actually resolve anything. I mean, we have the situation in Afghanistan, and here's me on record saying that I was anti this, the whole war in Afghanistan and Pakistan becoming part of this war. And I was told both times that, look, the war in Afghanistan will be over in a few weeks, and Pakistan will only be involved in it for a few weeks. So, 19 years down the line, we have a situation. Again, by the way, we are still hoping. I've spoken to President Trump. We are trying now to get the talks restarted between Taliban and the Americans. And hopefully, if the deal is signed, which was almost about to be signed, then I would try and meet the Taliban to convince them to talk to the Afghan government then. Because until now, that's where the hitch was. Taliban were talking to the Americans, but not to the Afghan government. So Pakistan is affected by this, by all the turmoil in Afghanistan. We desperately want there to be peace, also for the sake of people of Afghanistan. Also, this would be a tragedy for not just Pakistan, but I mean for all developing countries with their budgets being affected if this war takes place and the oil prices shoot up. It's going to cause much more poverty, so we'll try our best in both cases.
Thank you. James, Al Jazeera, and after this, if I can't identify somebody, please identify yourself before you ask a question. James, go ahead.
James Bayes from Al Jazeera. On Kashmir, I've heard absolutely everything you've said, but I still want to ask this question. You're here in New York. Prime Minister Modi is here in New York. You both had meetings with President Trump. Is there a possibility of face-to-face diplomacy? Is there a chance for diplomacy on Kashmir?
Look, 5th August, Pakistan tried everything. I spoke to President Modi too, saying we have similar problems. Our problem is poverty, above anything. The responsibility of the head of state above anything is to get people out of poverty. And conflict is one that creates poverty. And sadly, as I said, there was no response. Now, after the 5th of August, I'm afraid, what is the point of talking now? What they had done to Kashmir, unless and until they lift the curfew and then restore that Article 370, there's no chance of talking. So that's why we've asked President Trump and other world leaders to intervene.
The lady in pink right here.
Thank you very much. Mr. Prime Minister, you're a man of enormous sophistication, and you're aware, I know, that there are very often forces behind the kinds of conflicts you're facing now. You have mentioned the Security Council. Now, one of my concerns, if this issue becomes before the Security Council, is there has been a tendency to attack Islamic countries, Iraq, Libya, and now Syria. And wouldn't it be risky to get the Security Council with its multiple interests conflicting involved in this? What would your expectation or hope be?
Look, I mean, if ever the Security Council has to move, it's now. And I'll say for two reasons. One, the people of Kashmir are suffering simply because the Security Council could not implement its decision to allow them the right of self-determination, the 11 resolutions. So it's their responsibility. 8 million people are locked inside for 50 days. It's inhuman. So what is the Security Council for then? Second, this has a potential of the unthinkable. Two nuclear armed countries face to face. Surely the Security Council came into being to stop this. I mean, this is as bad as it gets.
Yeah.
So here's me, the reason I started by saying, I would not have come out of Pakistan because, you know, we are just about coming out of a really difficult economic situation and governance issues and fighting a corrupt mafia. I would not have come here. But I'm alarmed because here's me, there's one prime minister that side, there's one this side. You know, a sane mind can't think of a nuclear war. Mm. No sane mind can think of it. We grew up and after the Cuban crisis, and all of us sort of knew that the Cold War was there because the other war was unimaginable. But when you have what you have in India right now, and I say this, who knows India? This is an ideology, a racist ideology, which believes in the supremacy of a Hindu race. The other races are not supposed to be equal. How do you reason with them? How do you reason with what they've done in Kashmir? I mean, would you expect a civilized society to do what they've done? I'm locked in, 8 million people. So therefore, I'm worried that if this goes on, there can easily be a miscalculation. And that's why the United Nations must act.
Mr. Prime,
the lady in the white suit at the back, please identify yourself. We'll come to you, Mateen, in a minute. Let's just take some ANCA members.
Thank you very much. My name is Nazira Azim Karimi. I'm Afghan journalist. Mr. Khan, as Afghan people are high expectation because from you, because you're peace ambassador, you are very famous soccer player. Million of
ball game. Ball game, more or less the same. Ball is involved.
As a peace ambassador, which role Pakistan should play to bring Taliban and the table to make negotiation with the Afghan government? What is the reason why they don't want to talk with Afghan government?
Thank you.
Well, this was a sticking point, as you're right, that the Taliban were willing to talk to the Americans, but not to the Afghan government. At one point, the Taliban wanted to meet me, but I asked the Afghan government, and they asked me not to meet them. So the reason they said was that until President Ghani came to Pakistan, only then afterwards I should meet them. So I was planning to meet them once they had signed the deal with the Americans, and I would have met them for only one reason, that they should now talk to the Afghan government. But unfortunately, on a tweet, we found out that the deal was off. But, you know, it's very sad because that was very close. And once the deal was made, then, you know, the progress would have been made. But let me just be clear. There is no military solution, which is what I've been saying for a long time. And once the Afghans get together, they will find a solution. It must be, you know, if the government sits down with the Taliban, they'll find a solution. But instead of getting them there.
If the car, APP.
Thank you, Mr. Prime Minister, from the Associated Press of Pakistan. For weeks, you have been calling for lifting of siege in Indian occupied Kashmir. And in this connection, you have met representatives of international humanitarian organizations. What is it that prevents them to carry out their mandated task of providing relief to the Kashmiri people and to the and to visit the prisoners, which they are mandated to do?
To be absolutely frank, I am a bit disappointed by international community. I'm disappointed first because, you know, if 8 million Europeans were put under siege like this for 50 days, or Jews were put under siege, or Americans were put under siege, well, forget Americans, even 8 Americans were put under siege, but I'm talking about any other. I mean, would the reaction have been the same? You know, they make statements, and there is no pressure as yet on Narendra Modi to lift the siege. So we will keep mounting the pressure. And I will tell the UN, I mean, I'm speaking on Friday, I will tell them that if there is a massacre, I mean, what are 900,000 troops doing there? When India says that, you know, these Pakistan is sending terrorists, 500 terrorists, what can 500 terrorists do in front of 900,000 troops? Why would you send 500 terrorists as what they're saying? 900,000 troops are not to fight terrorists. They are to control, intimidate, and subjugate a population. And population, the entire Muslim population, I mean. This is why it is going to have repercussions far beyond Kashmir. Because 1.3 billion Muslims are watching this. Where is the world community? Where is the international community? Where are laws? United Nations Security Council had given them that right of self-determination. And what is happening to them now? So this will have repercussions. It's going to create radicalization. This is going to get worse. I'm flagging it right now because this is just the beginning. Once the curfew is lifted, God knows what is going to happen after that. Do they expect that the people of Kashmir, who already lost 100,000 people in over 30 years, do they think that just because India has revoked Article 370, they will quietly accept the status quo? They will accept that India has taken over and annexed Kashmir? Of course, this is going to be there's likely every likelihood of there being a massacre. So the world community will be responsible.
Mateen Heather.
Can I just add to what the Prime Minister said to your question, sir? The President of the ICRC met the Prime Minister yesterday, and he said that in order to go and operate in Jammu and Kashmir, Indian-occupied side, they need permits. They have applied for permits, and they have neither been refused nor been given permits. So practically, they're inaccessible.
Yes, Mr. Prime Minister over here, Mateen Heather, So you just expressed disappointment over international community's cold response. But you are saying at the same time you are making all efforts, meeting world leaders. What is the reason India is unmoved? And when you met President Trump, again he said that he is ready to mediate if requested. So when he will be requested? And second part of it, how serious is the threat of attack or adventure from the Indian side? And what is your defense preparation? Do we have the capability to thwart any possible aggression from India with full force? Thank you, Mr. Prime Minister.
Look, I'm disappointed because I really feel, not as a Pakistani Prime Minister, as a human being, I feel disappointed that how can the world community stay quiet when 8 million people are being treated worse than animals? It's just a simply disappointment coming from there. Secondly, I know why the response is lukewarm, and I know why Mr. Modi is not pushed at the moment. The reason is because India, people look upon India as a market of 1.2 billion people. Sadly, this is what is happening. Material comes over the human. So it's because it's a big market, they know it's wrong. Everyone I've spoken to knows this is wrong. Some are appalled by it. But they keep quiet because in the end they start thinking of a market. But my simple message to all those who are looking at a big market, this can go very wrong. To your point, to your second question, last time when they made Pakistan an excuse for this, a boy brutalized by the Indian security forces who blew himself up, they blamed Pakistan and bombed us. And once a conflict starts between two nuclear-armed countries, and I told the Indian public too on television, I said it will go beyond me, my hands, or your Prime Minister's hands once it starts. Who knows where it's going to end up? So it's madness to allow this this whole situation to deteriorate further, because it's only going to deteriorate. Again, I repeat, what will happen when you lift the curb? What is going to happen? What do they think that the Kashmiris, after how they've treated them, are they going to quietly now accept India, that India has taken over Kashmir and they'll accept it? I fear there's going to be a bloodbath. And that's when things will start deteriorating very rapidly.
I know you all want to ask questions. I'll come to you one by one. The lady in the blue, please go ahead and if you can identify yourself. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. Thank you, Mr. Prime Minister. Betül Yürük from the Turkish news agency Anadolu. You had a meeting with Turkish President Erdogan yesterday. Do you think Turkey could play a role to help resolve the issue between Pakistan and India? Thank you.
Well, first of all, I really want to thank President Erdogan for mentioning today Kashmir in his speech. We really feel that I hope that after him, more leaders take his lead and at least ask India to lift the siege. We have a very, very good relationship with Turkey. And President Erdogan is coming over to Pakistan next month, which we hope to receive. We hope to increase our trade, all sorts of, we're going to have financial agreements with Turkey. And yes, we are very thankful that the president has taken a very principled stand.
Please go ahead. We'll come to you, sir, in a minute.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the press conference, Mr. Prime Minister. My name is Ibtisam Azim from the Daily Arabic, Al Arab Al Jadid newspaper. My question to you is, you said that you will keep mounting the pressure. Could you tell us which steps are you going to take? And then to which extent are you afraid that the situation of Kashmir will be very similar to what's happening in the occupied Palestinian territories, where you have a lot of resolutions, a lot of sympathy, but on the ground there is no concrete steps to help the local people? Thank you very much.
You see, just like until the Palestinians are given a just settlement, there will always be a problem there. But, you know, of course, Israel is very powerful and probably at the peak of its might. And so for the time being, they've put a lid on it. But eventually there has to be some settlement there, with a just settlement where the Palestinians have a homeland. I think that Kashmir is going to be a bit different. For 30 years, Kashmir, people of Kashmir have wanted, this freedom movement has grown. Today, the act done by the Indian government of shutting people in their homes for 50 days has alienated the entire spectrum of Kashmiri public. There were times people who were pro-Indian and who were, you know, as I say, there were Kashmiri leaders like Umar Abdullah and Mehbooba Mufti who were pro-India. Today, no one will be able to ever get a vote in Kashmir who's pro-India because of what they've done. And they've actually, what the BJP government has done is it has actually told the Kashmiris that you're not equal human beings. They do not consider them human beings. Only hence a mindset can put people inside what they've done. And not thinking through what happens once the siege is lifted. I do not think Narendra Modi knows what's going to happen.
The gentleman right here. Yes.
After this, we are going to have an OIC summit meeting. We will gather all the Muslim countries, simply for one thing. The only reason the people of Kashmir are being subjected to this is because they are Muslims. And this is resonating in 1.3 billion Muslims. And it's very important for Muslim world to play its part, because they are only suffering because they are Muslims. The Hindu Kashmiris are not suffering. And that's why it is important for them to take a stand. Because if the Muslim countries don't take a stand for whatever reason, for their own trade or whatever agreements, That's what leads to radicalization when the governments do not express the wishes of the people and when they see injustice. So I hope that, you know, the Muslim countries, we will have the OIC meeting next month.
Joseph Klein of Canada Free Press, you've been quoted as saying that Pakistan had originally trained al-Qaeda forces, and also that you regretted the decision by the Pakistani government after the 9/11 attack to side with America against the what were then referred to as terrorists. What assurances have you given to President Trump that Pakistan will indeed help in the fight against terrorists, including within Pakistan, that are aligned with the Taliban? Because I believe the second in command in the Provisional Transition Commission or Council that was being considered has significant ties with the terrorist organization in Pakistan. So what kind of assurances are you willing to give?
Let me, what I said, and let me explain it in the exact context which I spoke. 1979, the Soviets invaded Afghanistan. 1980-81, the Americans decided to back Pakistan, back the freedom struggle in Afghanistan. And in the 80s then, jihad was declared against the Soviets, and Muslims from all over the world were invited to participate in the jihad, means a freedom struggle for Afghanistan against the Soviets. Amongst them were al-Qaeda. All these different organizations, Mujahideen groups, all arrived in Pakistan to defeat the Soviets in Afghanistan. And of course, Pakistan trained them, but they were funded by the Americans, by the Western countries, because all the Western countries backed the Afghan jihad. So my whole point was, and then Mujahideen, who were doing, the Russians would call terrorism, but then we would call them freedom fighters. They were trained in the art of guerrilla warfare, which the Russians called terrorism. And so when the Soviets left, my whole point is that the United States also packed up and left. And we were left with the groups. So I was just explaining how come when they talk about Pakistan having these groups, this is how we ended up having the groups. If it would have been, which is what we hope now, we hope that there's a proper transition from Taliban, from when the Americans pull out of Afghanistan, we hope there's a transition to a proper political solution rather than just packing up and going as happened in 89. There will again be chaos in Afghanistan. So my whole point is that when they left, chaos happened in Afghanistan. Pakistan had the fallout. We were left with these groups, all dressed up and nowhere to go. And we were blamed in the end. After 9/11, when the same groups from Mujahideen turned into terrorists, Pakistan was blamed for it. We were given the job now to clear this up. And we ended up losing 70,000 people from 2003 onwards. And so my whole point is that either we should not have participated in the Afghan jihad. Once we had participated, then we should not have been part of the American war on terror, because they turned the people who had been trained against the Soviets and foreign occupation. When the Americans occupied Afghanistan, they turned on Pakistan.
Azim Mia, and then Jazeb of ARY. Azim Mia, please go ahead.
Mr. Prime Minister, now you have met President Trump, so he has met Modi also. He has met him on both sides, and looks like he has got a tilt towards India. So that's one option.
Secretary General says that the resolutions on Kashmir were not under Chapter 7. So according to the procedure of the Secretariat, Chapter 6 resolutions are non-binding. And in all that kind of a situation, what are the options left, you know, except appealing to the international
community? Because the international community looks like that right now, in the face of Indian-American alliance, things are getting bad. So what, you know, what procedures you are going to adopt, and what is your approach, and where are you heading? Thank you.
Azim, did you say I begged President Trump?
No, you met President
Trump. Oh, thanks. You I don't. I've never begged any from anyone. So I have met, and I apprised President Trump exactly of the situation, and I have told him, like I have told you, the gravity of the situation. This could go serious. Look, intelligent human beings start thinking ahead. I mean, you have to think of the hope for the best, but you should be prepared for the worst. The worst scenario in this is unthinkable. Normal human beings do not think of that. And so therefore, it is my job to tell them, in my opinion, things will deteriorate. We will keep them apprised. At least we have informed the world community what's going on. And as time goes on, and I fear that this is going to end up in a massacre, at least we will be able to tell the world community. And if India blames Pakistan for this, then at least the world would know about it. Previously, it was anything that happened in India. Look, what has been going on in the past? After 9/11, you used that magic word, Islamic terrorism, and all humanitarian rights were waved aside. You could do whatever you like with the people, provided you could term them as Islamic terrorist. And this is exactly what Narendra Modi is doing. This near genocide which he's about to commit, he's blaming it on Islamic terrorism, hoping that he'll get away with it. And that's why it's important for us to communicate with the Western world and civilized world and tell them what is happening. That's why we're telling them, send your own observers and find out what's happening. If India has nothing to worry about, and guess what the excuse of shutting down, putting people under curfew and shutting them in their houses for 50 days, the excuse is that this is to develop Kashmir. This is for prosperity of Kashmir. This is what the Narendra Modi position is. So it's important for us to tell the world, and I know now, I'm satisfied that at least everyone knows. I've apprised all the major world leaders of the situation in Kashmir.
The follow-up question is...
No, Azimia. There are other people who want to ask a question. Go ahead, Jazeb.
Thank you, Ambassador Malia. This is Jazeb Ali from Irvine University, Pakistan. Prime Minister, like President Trump, Secretary General of the United Nations also offered to mediate between India and Pakistan on Kashmir issue. Kashmir issue. So, sir,
can we meet him? We still have to meet him.
Sir, will you comment on the role of United Nations? United Nations also failed to implement its own resolutions for the last many, many years. Okay. So, in your opinion, what's the reason for
that? Thank you, Jazeb.
Inshallah, you will see that this issue is not now going to die down. You will see in time.
Don. Anwar Iqbal or Masood Haider, you decide amongst the two.
Anwar.
Sorry. I have a very brief, very simple question. You are here, met world leaders, you will be speaking in 2 days, and you will go back. What other options
do you have now if the international committee does not respond?
Look, Anwar, let's be straight about this. What options have we got apart from this? I mean, we can't attack India if, you know, clearly that's not an option. Apart from that, we are doing everything possible. Apart from sort of, starting a war, we are doing everything possible we can. We are all the time exploring every possibility. We're making sure every world leader knows about the situation. I will be speaking on Friday as well, and I will try my best to make the world understand, and then media, I'm going to, I believe that the media is very powerful. The Western media, I had meetings last night, and I realized that a lot of them already know what is going on. And so I know what happened in Bosnia, when the ethnic cleansing of Muslims started in Bosnia, for a while the world did nothing. But the media put such a pressure that eventually the world had to do something. And I believe that in Kashmir, it's exactly the same thing will happen. Even though countries are worried about their economic interests and markets, I believe that this is a much bigger issue than markets and economic interest, and eventually the world will be interested.
Let's take Hassan from the Daily Times.
Mr. Prime Minister, in the past we have seen we had General Musharraf 4-point formula and we also had a Chenab formula. What proposal would you suggest to resolve Kashmir if you were able to talk to India in the near future?
Well, for a start, they have to lift the curfew. Mm-hmm. That's a beginning. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, this inhuman curfew of 50 days. Even the Congress Party in India has commented that poor people have been shut inside for 50 days. 50 days, they've no one knows what's happening with all the prisoners, political prisoners, thousands of them.
Thank you very much.
In that formula, there was a problem. And the problem was the third party, the most affected party, the Kashmiris, were not in the loop.
We have one last question. Go ahead.
Muhammad Ikram, Voice of America, U.S. service, we broadcast to Pashto region, Pakistan, Afghanistan. Did Trump ask you to play some role or actual role in Afghanistan? And did he tell you something about put some pressure on the Taliban? And what were you told?
I'll repeat what I said. We were very surprised because the deal was about to be signed when from a tweet we found out that the deal had been broken. So what we hope is that, and what we will try and do is to actually get back that deal to be signed. And then Pakistan will do its best to get the Taliban to talk to the Afghan government.
We did everything with the expected of us. We're done.
Prime Minister, as we know that there is no word of disappointment in your dictionary. Really appreciate as you have conveyed Pakistan's narrative loud and clearly across the world. During these days, you have met with different head of states, including Donald Trump. Now, in your opinion, what they are thinking and how much they are convinced, if no mediation, then what next?
Look, the disappointment is not because I think that people of Kashmir, I feel that what Narendra Modi has done, he has boxed himself into a blind alley. There is nowhere for him to go from now onwards except a general massacre of people of Kashmir when the curfew is lifted. There's no other way for him to go. So I feel that from now onwards, and I know that the people of Kashmir for 30 years have been fighting for their independence and 100,000 have lost their lives. They have lost fear of death. When a population, and you're talking about not a few thousands, 8 million people, when they lose fear of dying and freedom becomes much more important than living a life of slavery, I don't think that he will be able to stop this now. I think the momentum will gain pace. So I'm not disappointed about where it is headed because I know that this will eventually now end up in freedom for people of Kashmir. What I'm disappointed is that for some reason, countries put their economic interests ahead of human beings. This is the same with climate change. Countries, because of not wanting to lose their growth rate, do not realize that what impending disaster climate this climate change is bringing to the world. Neither do countries, for instance, which I'll be speaking about, this money laundering which comes from the developing world into the rich countries every year. Billions and billions of dollars from poor countries moves to rich countries through corruption, ruling elites of third developing world, taking the money out. And unfortunately, because if anything, the richer countries gain from it, they do not take any steps to stop it. This is a plunder of the poor countries. The poor countries are getting poorer. The rich are getting richer. And these criminals who plunder the poor countries have an easy way of parking their money, buying flats in New York and London. And that's what we want. We want the world to take notice of this. The richer countries, they should have strong money laundering laws. They should, if we can identify that money has been stolen from our countries, it should be immediately given back to us.
But no recovery so far.
But this is the problem, because the laws are so complicated, and if the rich countries want, they can easily